Hi and welcome to episode number 65 of the Introvert Biz Growth Podcast, the show where I talk to introverts who grow their business and make a difference. As always, I'm Sarah Senacroce, your host, and so excited that you're spending another episode with me. Have I ever told you about my Italian last name? I don't think so, at least not on this podcast. So as I'm in Sicily right now at our beach house, I thought I could start with that. So Santa Croce is my husband's last name, which I chose to adopt when I married him 16 years ago. I thought it really fit well with my first name, and I didn't mind that no one knows how to pronounce it. And I have to repeat it for every interview. How do you pronounce your name? Santa, like Santa Claus, and Croce, like Jim Croce. So, of course, that's how you say it in English. In Italian, it sounds like this, Santa Croce. It means Holy Cross, and there's a beautiful church in Florence with the same name if you ever get a chance to go there. It's a typical Sicilian name. Where my husband's parents are from, they emigrated to Canada, where he was born and raised, and where they still live. And I'll save the story about how my husband and I met for another time. So anyways, that's the story about my last name. So Santa, like Santa Claus, and Croce, like Jim Croce. Now, to today's episode, a conversation with Devin Smiley. Devin Smiley is a negotiation consultant for entrepreneurs, startups, and professionals who are sick of settling and ready to go after what they want, need, and deserve. She's distilled nearly 15 years and $5 billion of negotiation experience into accessible and actionable guidance that helps you build the skill set you need to make the ask with confidence. Devin's expert advice has been featured in Glamour magazine, the Chicago Tribune, and has helped clients including Mars Chocolate and Rolls-Royce. A strong believer that negotiation isn't just about boosting bottom lines, Devin works with pro bono partners including UN Women and the Clinton Foundation. I'm so excited to give you this conversation with Devin and me, who's actually very close to me right now. She just recently moved to Paris, so we actually made plans to eventually visit each other. So without further ado, here's the conversation with Devin Smiley. Devin, how are you today?
I'm doing well, Sarah. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you. It's so nice to have an interview with someone in the same time zone.
Oh, it's wonderful.
But I just told you, I got a bit of a scare because I was like, oh, it's 10 a.m. my time. So what time is that in the U.S.? Or first I thought maybe you're in Australia, but you're based in Paris. Oh my God.
Yeah, in Paris. We're practically neighbors.
Yes, exactly. You're going to have to go into that story in a little bit, but I want to start with kind of, you know, you're who you are and who you are as an introverted entrepreneur. And then, yeah, take us also to the Paris story, but start the business and the Devin story.
Sounds good. So I'm an introvert who also happens to be a negotiation consultant, which is something that I think a lot of people view as an oxymoron, because aren't negotiators super bold and out there and love talking and interacting with people all the time? And the answer is no, we're not always like that. Some of us are a little more introverted. So I had a background in corporate negotiation, and then about 4 years ago decided that small businesses, entrepreneurs, startups were really people who needed to learn how to negotiate. So I decided to leave the corporate world and start out on my own so that I could help that group of people develop their skills to make sure they weren't getting the short end of the stick in their negotiations.
Mm-hmm. What kind of negotiations? You're talking startup, so I immediately think, you know, investors finding money, and could it be any kind of negotiations, or is it usually money related?
It's really any type of negotiation. With startups specifically, I don't touch the venture capital, because that is a very special beast. Mm-hmm. And there are people who are wonderful at it. And so I've had to acknowledge that's not one of my strong suits. Mm-hmm. But where I usually end up involved is once they have the money, making sure they're not having it run through their fingers like water, by negotiating good deals with vendors, with partners. I help with building leadership skills. So when all of a sudden you've built a business based on something tech related, but now you find yourself as a founder, CEO, having a business discussion. Mm-hmm. There's a slightly different skill set required for when you're in those rooms.
Right.
And then with the small entrepreneurs, you know, the freelance writers, the graphic designers, a lot of it is around setting boundaries with clients, signing work that's, you know, more than $4 an hour. Because mm-hmm. sometimes they just love what they do so much, they don't really know how to say no to a client who's asking for a bit too much from them.
Yeah, that's definitely one of our favorite topics on this podcast. So I'm looking forward to dive into that. But I wanna go back a little bit more. So you said 4 years ago you started this journey as an entrepreneur, but take us back a bit more when you were still in the corporate world and how that felt being an introvert and how you then made the transition.
Well, I think reflecting back on my years in corporate, there was about a decade there. Mm-hmm. I think where being an introvert came into play for me is that I really didn't do a good job of networking. And I sort of relied on the fact that I did great work and that by merit alone, I would end up with opportunities and promotions. And I thought I could more safely sit back and stay out of the networking game. And I was wrong. So I think where it impacted me is I wish I had sort of learned to turn on a little bit more of an extroverted approach to make myself get more comfortable attending different events, meeting all the different people. I think that would have helped my career a lot.
Mm-hmm. So you saw extroverts doing that and progressing.
And I thought, there's another way. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I thought just based on the merit, based on continuing to do a great job, that I would end up in the same types of places. And that hadn't been the experience, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. Lessons learned, I think.
Right. So then you made this decision to, you know, go rogue and do it on your own. How did you find, you know, what to focus on? I mean, negotiation coach or however you call yourself, that's not exactly just mainstream and you see everybody doing that.
So exactly.
How did that come about?
Towards the end of my time in corporate, I was usually a frontline negotiator. So I'd be sitting down in front of a vendor, hashing out the deal. And in the last year or so, I started doing more mentoring internally. So junior employees, when it was their first time to step into that negotiation, they'd come to me, we'd walk through their strategy. I'd help them, you know, figure out what on earth their plan was going to be. And I realized that in those 1 hour conversations, they'd start so fearful, so scared. All their body language was so closed off and like their shoulders would be hunched down. And as our conversation progressed, they'd get a little spark in their eye. They'd sit up straighter. They'd be far more excited. And they'd leave the room really thinking, oh, I can do this. This is, like, I can negotiate. This isn't as difficult as I thought it would be. And it was seeing that transformation in people that made me think, this is something that feels good to me. It feels a lot better helping these people build their confidence than it does saving $10 million on a contract. Mm. I'd much rather be doing this as my work. Mm. And from there, it was the leap to help people outside the organization.
Mm. Interesting. And so who do you find yourself working with today mostly?
Mostly right now, what I love is that every client is so different. I think that really feeds my need for diversity. If I had to do the same thing every day, I would get a little bored. So right now I have got some wonderful clients who are in the brand design, web design space. So quite creative people who have amazing brains on the creative front. And I am constantly in awe of what they're coming up with, but I'm helping them build up the business side. And then a few more clients that are really more in the tech world, video game developers, app developers, helping them, you know, they come from the very technical world and I'm helping bring them into that business space as well. So I love that. Even today I have 3 different client calls and I'm going to be bouncing around between design, tech, and corporate. I'm so thrilled by that.
What I find really interesting is that you're saying design, right? So I'm assuming that this business or these business owners, what they can learn from you is negotiation, or I don't know if I would call it negotiation, but basically they are needing clients. They don't need, you know, a raise or, you know, investors or anything like that. Is that correct? They're wanting to learn skills on how to get better clients.
Exactly. So how they're structuring their offers, making sure they're not underpricing themselves. A lot of people end up with a lot of emotion when it comes to money.
Yes.
And the thought of actually asking for, you know, say $2,000 for the work you're doing feels very uncomfortable. So all of a sudden they're asking for $1,600 and then, oh no, that still feels bad. I'll ask for $1,200. Mm-hmm. Well, $1,200, you're not going to be able to pay the bills. Right. So helping them build the confidence to actually ask for what they really need and what they deserve for the work they're doing. Yeah. And then to have those conversations without being quite so nervous, without second guessing themselves.
Wow. I think the word confidence is kind of this overarching theme, isn't it?
Definitely.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely.
And do you think introverts, I mean, you're not only working with introverts, right?
Correct.
So do you think introverts are struggling more with that? Or maybe it's not the confidence thing that introverts are struggling more with, but more, yeah, I don't know. I just feel like extroverts are a bit more daring when it comes to asking for money.
Well, I think that a real strength the introverts I work with have had is that they take the time to really reflect.
Mm-hmm.
And so they will have quite a lot of confidence in themselves and in their figures. They aren't just sort of throwing ideas out there. They've really spent the time even getting to know themselves for what their strengths are. And so they come to the table with quite a well-formed idea, and then it's actually opening their mouth to say it that right. becomes the difficulty. Mm-hmm. I find with some extroverts, they perhaps move a little quicker in the planning phase. They're very excited to get out there and share their idea and start making their pitches. But it may not be as fully formed of an idea when they're leaping into action.
Right.
So
interesting. So tell us a bit about your business model. How do you currently generate revenue? Is it mostly one-on-one coaching or do you have other offerings?
Right now it's mostly one-on-one coaching, which is mentorship. Mm-hmm. Sometimes clients, they're in a panic. They need one quick call. You know, we get them on their way. The work I really loved doing over the past year or so is working 4-month to 6-month mentorships
right.
with clients to really see them develop and to be there to hold their hand as they go through these experiences. I find at the beginning, there's quite a lot of hand holding and pep talks and getting them going with strategy. And then as our time together is coming to a close, I'm just getting the emails like, oh, guess what I did yesterday? It was fabulous. And they're telling me the story of their success.
Right.
And I have these proud negotiation mama moments because they're flying on their own and, you know, they're still checking in with home base, making sure everything's okay, but they've really built the skill to the point where they don't need to rely on me anymore.
Yeah.
Which is a terrible business model on my part, perhaps.
You need to come up with another revenue
stream. Exactly. I need to keep them needing me somehow.
Yeah.
But nothing makes me happier than to see a client, you know, even 6 months a year after we've worked together, send that email and share that success with me.
Yeah.
Just so validating.
It's true. And what they're doing is really building these skills, the confidence for the rest of their lives. So
oh,
it's
exactly.
not just a thing that yeah.
Once we're never going to stop meeting.
They don't have anymore.
Oh yeah. All my negotiations for life are all done now. No more.
Great. Well, we talked a lot about other people. Let's talk about your introverted superpowers. So besides negotiation, of course, what do you think are your biggest strengths as an introverted entrepreneur?
I think one of my biggest strengths is that I am able to be an observer in a crowded environment, in a busy meeting, and I am comfortable not saying anything and just absorbing all the information, all the details, and then using that sort of my brain does this great thing where all of a sudden the important bits of info kind of light up and they all come together into the strategy. And I think that has been a real power because in an environment where a lot of people talk, to actually be the one listening has quite a bit of value. So I think that's definitely one of my superpowers.
Yeah. I think you really phrased it really well because usually we just say, yeah, we're good listeners, mm-hmm. but listening is one thing, but observing and then kind of come out with a strategy, and maybe while all these people talk all the time, we just, our brain does that thing like you said, and then when we talk, we actually kind of summarize everything that everybody has.
Exactly.
And it's like, oh, wow. Mm. So Devin does speak. And when she speaks, it's like the solution is right here.
Yeah, so. Which I think, because a lot of people, they're so busy talking that they're not really making the connections.
Exactly. Yeah, and I think you're so right. They're just focusing on the next thing that they want to say.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So we can definitely use that to our advantage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like that word because, yeah, observing, because right now it was, you know, mostly what I heard was listening, but observing is kind of a different nuance to it. So what would you say about, you know, kind of challenges that come with being an introvert and running a business?
I actually have to go out and talk to all the people now.
Yeah.
Which I think when I started the entrepreneur journey, you know, what feels like many moons ago, 4 years isn't really that long. It feels like forever. I thought I could just sort of have a nice blog and write a bunch of great articles, which is my comfort zone, and business would come to me. Mm-hmm. And it turns out that's not actually how it works. Mm-hmm. I had to actually go out there and meet people. And one of my weaknesses is that when I know I need to do something like that, it feels a little unnatural to me and I'm scared. Mm-hmm. And so I procrastinate. Mm-hmm. And I have procrastinated my way out of a lot of great opportunities over the years because I was too slow to find that courage to actually attend the event or make the phone call and have that interaction. It's something I'm still working on.
Yeah. I was in the same place where I thought I had to go networking because mm-hmm. that's where you get business. And I did it for 2 years, but to me, honestly, Devin, it just still didn't work. Even though I did it and I was there, it was not where I was in my best. And so I actually found other ways, like, you know, running a podcast, running webinars, things that feel more comfortable to me, because I don't need to go out there and put on this mask. I think for me, really what was wrong with networking is I felt like I need to put on my business mask. Mm-hmm. Because I know, well, I think that in France, it's probably similar to Switzerland, where, you know, it's still kind of this stiff business networking stuff going on, where everybody just hands and exchanges business cards and says who they are and their title. And so I would love to encourage you to look up the LinkedIn local events, because mm-hmm. that's what I'm hosting here in Lausanne. And it's this new type of networking where, at least the way we host it here in Switzerland, is really much more focused on the people, on the person, human to human relationships, mm-hmm. and not just as, you know, business networking where you exchange business cards. So look them up. I'm sure there's one in Paris. Yeah. Because networking, of course, is just the biggest challenge for all of us introverts.
Oh, exactly. And one thing I've noticed, because I feel like since I arrived in France, it's been about 9 months now, my second job is like professional event attender. I go to a lot of events because that's how I'm going to meet the people. And what I've noticed is my most, I'm going to say valuable, and I don't mean that in a monetary sense, but perhaps my most enriching connections have actually been made at non-business events.
Yeah. Exactly.
And it's like getting out of the door and going to a wine tasting mm-hmm. and meeting, you know, 10 really fabulous people and connecting over a little cheese and a bit of Merlot.
Yeah,
has been a really great experience versus what you meant, the churn of like, hey, here's my business card. Can you help me? No, you can't help me. Goodbye.
Yeah.
Oh, I hate those.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm just launching with the same friend. I'm launching a walk and talk event where it's like an intimate event where we, you know, just open the invitation up to 10 people. And during a lunch break, we walk together. You know, Switzerland is beautiful, has a nice lake, but even Paris, you know, there's all these great parks. So you walk and talk to get to really know each other as human beings. So everything, you know, from life to health to family and business, everything
That's a great idea.
And so, you know, sometimes us introverts were great at launching our own networking events, because then people come to us because we're the organizers. And so the conversations are much easier, I find. So just food for thought there.
I love it.
All right. Well, take me to an aha moment. Maybe it was that time where you realized, okay, that's it. I need to do my own thing or something else. Tell me the story of this aha moment.
Ah, so connected to the decision to go out and do my own thing is I had an aha moment about 7 years ago. And I was sitting at my desk at my little cubicle, and I'd been daydreaming about, you know, just packing a suitcase, getting my little dog in a carrier, and spending a month in Paris. I thought, wouldn't it be cool to live like a local for 1 month? And as I was daydreaming, I had this thought cross my mind, well, no, you're not that type of person. And I caught myself, because what exactly did I mean? I wasn't the type of person to be able to spend a month in Paris. What type of person was that? Why was I not that? Right. You know, what would I do if that wasn't for me? And it was a great aha moment in terms of some of the limitations I had been placing on myself. So yes, I was the type of person who could go spend a month in Paris. And I did it. And it was fabulous.
And now you live there. Oh my
God. I live here. So it turns out I very much am that type of person.
Right.
But then when it was the thought of, oh, I want to help small business owners. I want to help individuals. I'm going to become an entrepreneur. The same little voice comes in. Well, you're not that type of person.
Mm-hmm.
Like, one, you know how much networking you're going to have to do? You're not that type of person. And I limited myself for ages. It must have been about a year that I sat with that idea and hadn't taken action on it. And it was, again, catching myself. No, you can be any type of person you choose to be.
Right.
Just take the action and go for it. If you have that idea and you're that excited about it, go for it, baby.
Yeah. It's so true how our mind can play us tricks and put these limiting beliefs into our head. But it's also true how we can change it, you know? We can.
Oh, exactly.
Yeah.
Great
story. Thank you for sharing that. Let's change gears and talk about some kind of practical things. One personal habit something you do on a regular basis that contributes to your success.
A big trick of mine, and this is one of my, you know, as an introvert who needs to sort of turn the dial up and become an extrovert every once in a while, at least on the surface, one of my top habits is that every event in my agenda, I still use a paper agenda, a little old fashioned like that. Every event that requires a big energy output, a social interaction, I highlight in blue. And so from 1 week to the next, I can see how energy sapping my schedule is lining up to be. And it's a nice visual, quick glance of like, yeah, Wednesday is going to be a tough day. Which means Thursday, I am not booking anything. So Thursday will have no blue highlight because I know I'm going to need the time to recover.
Right.
And I find that that's really helped me in the last few years better manage my energy during the weeks and to even be able to set limits when I have had a really heavy week of extroversion. And then a friend asks me to go to a dinner party on the Saturday night. And I know to say no.
Yeah.
Because I am not going to be the best person to be sitting at a table with 20 other people that evening. I need my me time.
Right.
So that's probably been one of the biggest helps. Very low tech, but a big help.
Yeah, no, it is. And you can do the same thing on the Google calendar with using color codes. And
oh, exactly.
So yeah, great idea. And yeah, planning in me time as well, like recovery time. After.
Oh, definitely. That was my day yesterday for me. It was, I'd had a really heavy week and it would have been a wonderful week. I mean, I met a lot of great people. I saw some old friends. I was like, no, Sunday. It's like, go to the grocery store first thing in the morning and then nothing.
Right.
Just me.
Yeah.
It was bliss.
Tell us about something that you use online, like an internet resource that you can share with our listeners.
Ooh, a good one I found is an app called Shaper, S-H-A-P-R. And it's sort of like Tinder, but for business, because it's based on swiping back and forth on different people's profiles. Right. You get more than a picture. You get a little brief sort of 140 characters of what the person does and what their interests are with a few hashtags. But it's really meant to help you with networking one-on-one. So you swipe if you want to meet someone. If they swipe yes to you, then it's a match. And you can send each other messages on the app. And the goal of it is that you then actually meet in person. And I have loved this app. I've used it for, it's been about 6 months now, and at least 2 times a week I'm meeting up with someone just for a coffee.
Oh, nice.
And it's a nice low-key way to connect with people without the hustle and bustle of a big room.
Right.
But it's sort of like the app is the big room, and you're able to sift through without having to go through all the awkward small talk of actually being there.
That's great. I remember now that I have used it, but I think it's bigger in France than it is in Switzerland, because here I didn't find anybody on it.
Where is everyone?
Yeah, I think it's pretty big in France. Is it international, or is it French?
It's a French company, but they're pretty big in London, or England. Uh-huh. And they're also big in the U.S. The U.S., I think, might be their biggest market.
Yeah. Well, Switzerland, we're always the last to cut jobs. Maybe in 2 years.
I'll help them work all the bugs out over here in France before you guys get it.
Great. What about a book that you would recommend to the BizGrowth audience, and why?
A book I would really recommend it's a friend of mine who wrote it. And she's also helped me through a lot of my limiting inner voice issues. Her book's called Hilda, and it's written by Coach Jenny, because her last name is very, very long and hard to pronounce and spell. So it's Hilda by Coach Jenny, and it's all about that inner voice we have. She calls hers Hilda, and it's the different ways Hilda speaks up and gets in your way. And then how on earth to just put Hilda in her place so you can move on and do what you need to be doing.
Right.
So it's a really great book. It's one of those ones where you read a page and you think, oh no, that's so me. Right. And then she has you laughing the next second. So
that's great.
It becomes a positive.
I like the title. It's
Hilda.
You know, it's just like a name, and it sounds very, very personable. So
exactly. And it's that, what was it? One of the exercises she had us do, and I've known Coach Jenny for years, is to actually name our inner voice.
Right.
Because when we call it an inner voice, it makes it sound very serious and very, official. Right. She's like, give it a funny name.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know, I call mine Louise. So Louise speaks up. And other people, Mr. Higginbottom is another one. People just come up with a silly name, because all that negative commentary that voice is sending to you is silly commentary.
Right. That's a great exercise. Great. I'll make sure to link to that. As I told you offline, I've added a new question recently, and it's all about marketing with integrity. So that's something that it has been on my mind for the last a few months. And I want to know what that means for you and your business. What does that mean, marketing with integrity? How do you feel about your marketing that you're doing?
When I think about that, for me, the integrity, what that points to for me, is not marketing things just because I think they'll sell, and really trying to stay true to what I am best at. Just because I can do something doesn't mean I should do something, doesn't mean I should be trying to get people to pay me for it. Sticking more to my core capabilities and really putting those as my leading message, which I think is sometimes a struggle, because when you see an opportunity in the market, you kind of want to go, oh, I can want to jump on that. That would be great. But like, no, hold to the core, be true to how you work best and how you can help people the best. That's what comes up for me with that.
Right. Do you think introverts would struggle more with compromising their integrity? So trying something like that, where they're, selling some marketing product that has nothing to do with their business or core skills, just to make money?
I'm not sure. I think introverts might be okay with it on like on the inside because, mm-hmm. you know, to make money isn't a bad thing. Mm-hmm. But I think that given that we already have to sort of work up our energy to put ourselves out there, to be amongst the people, that there would be enough roadblocks coming up that they probably wouldn't be as effective
right.
at marketing with the lack of integrity. Mm-hmm. It's harder to get that motivation if it doesn't feel 100% right.
Right. Great. Thanks so much for sharing your thoughts on that. We're coming to the end here. And my final question is always a mindfulness question. So what are you grateful for today or this week, Devin?
Oh, that's a good one. I think what I'm very grateful for right now is having friends who know me better than I know myself. And they all have the patience to be there for me, to listen and guide as I am trying to catch up to them in figuring out how I tick.
That's great. I was just thinking, do I have friends who know me better than I know myself? I love that. Yeah, that way to define who your real friends are, I guess, yeah. Right? That's
there's a few, and they sit me down sometimes and have a bit of a truth talk. And I'm always amazed and humbled and grateful, sometimes a little annoyed because I really wish I'd seen it myself.
Because they point out things you're going, yeah, I guess I knew that. I just didn't want to know about it.
I knew it, but I didn't want to know it. But yeah, they're there for me. And it's always said with love, which is important. And a lot of patience with me as I finally reach the same realizations.
That's wonderful. Well, thank you so much for your time, Devin. Thanks so much for talking.
It's so great to chat.
Yeah, it was wonderful. And again, whenever you want to come and hop on the TGV and come and visit me in Lausanne, let me know.
Will do.
Wonderful. Thanks so much, Devin.
Thanks, Sarah.
That's it for today's episode. Please go to devonsmiley.com to find out more about Devin or to get her tips on how to negotiate. You'll find this episode's show notes at sarahsenecroce.com/episode65. And if you're listening to this show on a mobile device, you can click on the description and you'll actually find all the clickable links there. Now, I haven't asked in a while because, as you probably know, it's not easy for an introvert to ask for help. But if you enjoy my podcast, there are a few options that you can help me out. You can share it, for example, on your social media outlets. You can share it via direct message with an introverted friend. Leave me a review on iTunes or Stitcher or whatever else you're listening this podcast on. Or just send me a personal message via my website. Always makes my day to hear from you guys. This is Sarah Senacroce signing off from the Introvert Biz Growth Podcast. Remember, you need to use your unique introverted superpowers in order to make a difference.